Hey, Kevin Bartini joins us from the Upper West Side of Manhattan. You want to see Kevin Bartini headline? Of course you do. He'll be in Princeton at Catch a Rising Star, November 15th through the 16th. Go see Kevin Bartini perform at Catch a Rising Star in Princeton. Hello there, sir.
Hello. How are you, my friend?
Much better now that I hear your voice.
I'm melting inside.
And I thought we would try something different today.
I think that's a great idea. Okay. I'm looking forward to our new adventure here.
You know, a lot of people write in with problems. I can't solve everybody. I can solve some of your problems or not. I can't, you know, what can one man do? So I thought
there's only so many hours in a day.
Yeah. So I thought you would help me answer some people's personal problems.
Okay.
All right. And you know more about life than I do. You're successfully married. You're romantic.
Well, I'm an old romantic at heart. I suppose you could say that.
And your wife genuinely loves you.
You know what? It looks that way on Facebook.
No, you surprised her.
No.
Took her to Milan.
Uh-huh.
You're romantic. You're a better man than I am. So here's our first question.
Okay, let's do it.
Dear David, the problem I'm about to tell you is one you've probably never heard before.
Oh.
My husband and I have been married for 14 years. We have two great sons. My husband and I have had problems that we've tried to resolve through counseling, but it's not working. So I'm leaving him because I'm still young enough to make a happier life for myself.
Mm-hmm.
I thought somebody was writing in with a problem. This sounds like heaven. I called my father-in-law and asked to see him privately so he wouldn't be too shocked when I left his son. Well, he picked me up and we went for a drive out in the country. When I gave him my news, he gave me some. He said he and his wife never had a really good marriage, but he stayed with her because of their children who are all grown up now. Then he told me he's always had special feelings for me.
Ooh.
But he would never follow through on them because I belong to his son. Make a long story short, we both confessed our love to one another, and now we want to spend the rest of our lives together.
Wow.
But we don't know how my sons would feel about having their grandfather for a stepfather.
Mm-hmm.
You only live once. What should we do?
Wow. Well, first of all, I would just, how did they close out the letter? Did they sign it like Love Struck in Alabama, something like that? Did they sign
Betty.
Off?
Betty.
Well, I mean, that's there's a lot of gross going on there. You're obviously, you got to wonder what her husband was like. That would even be a decision in her life, like that. You know, what kind of a screwed up person is he that she would even think to do something like leave him for his own father?
Well, I mean, first of all, who calls their father-in-law and says, I need to see you privately?
Right.
Because I'm leaving your son. Nobody does that unless Betty has plans. She wanted
Betty and her father-in-law, obviously there's been an unspoken thing going on, right? For years. There's been footsie under the table. There's been stolen glances, something like that. So, yeah. So there, yeah. Otherwise, you know, so he's not so shocked. No, I don't buy that at all.
I say they should get married.
Uh-huh.
And go for it. Because how old? It's the father is a boomer, right?
I would imagine so.
Okay. So, yes, boomer. Go for it. I'm so, you know, okay, boomer. Have you heard this new meme that's going on?
I have. Huh? Yes, I have. Yeah, okay, boomer.
Okay, boomer.
Mm-hmm.
She wants you. What is more exciting than cuckolding your own son?
You know,
It's a reverse Oedipal thing. It's beautiful.
No,
because
totally.
He secretly wants to kill you and sleep with your mother.
Right.
This is, You're getting even. Freud would say, go for it. Kill him before he kills you. Yeah, I say,
if you want, I don't have any kids, nor up until this moment have I ever planned to, but just the idea of, you know, being a fella who's got to be, you know, this guy's got to be at least 60, right? 60, 65. And the fact that he has more game and can steal from his own son,
mm-hmm.
That's right up there. I mean, there, as far as virile and whatever, you know, any 60-year-old, you know, millionaire can get a trophy wife. That means nothing. You know, that's just your bank account. But if you're able to, if this guy isn't rich, if he's just an average working Joe and he's got enough swagger that he can steal his own son's wife.
Go for it, baby.
A decade and a half. Have at it.
And it's not going to last.
Oh, no.
No, very few marriages last, especially with your former stepdaughter.
Uh-huh.
Live in the moment, like the woman says, like Betty said to us, I only live once.
Yeah, you only live once. Go for it.
Okay.
So then if she gets married, her sons become their own uncles?
Except in West Virginia.
It's gonna make things complicated as the holidays are coming up. But YOLO, baby, YOLO.
The heart wants what the heart wants.
And the old Viagra-pumped penis wants what the old Viagra-pumped penis wants as well.
Yes.
And go for it.
Okay.
Okay.
Next letter comes to us. I've been married for 7 years to a wonderful man, and I love him dearly. He has an 8-year... Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
I've been married for 7 years to a wonderful man, and I love him dearly. He has an 8-year-old daughter from a previous marriage.
Uh-huh.
The problem is I can't bring myself to love this child. I can't stand to be around her. I've always felt this way, but it has become worse since I had my own daughter 2.5 years ago. My stepdaughter, let's call her Mary, is with us every other weekend and on holidays. And when Mary comes to stay, I get depressed because I feel like I have to pretend to like her. I don't hate her, and I would never hurt her. In fact, when she needs discipline, I bite my lip to keep from saying anything. Mary has a sassy mouth and can be very rude to adults. My husband is aware of my feelings for her, but he doesn't know how deep they are. I truly love my own daughter, and when my husband walks in on Fridays with Mary, I cringe. When he leaves with her on Sunday, I let out a sigh of relief. I hope one day things will get better, but right now I can't seem to get over my feelings.
What I like is where she says that, you know, she's always disliked Mary, which...
Who's 8 years old? 8 years old.
Which means she's 8 and you've been married for 7 years. So she was 1 year old when you got married and you already hated a baby. This is a person who hates a baby. right? What do you do in this situation?
Maybe Mary, the 8-year old, needs to change her behavior. Maybe I would advise you to sit down with Mary and say, Mary, uh-huh. don't take this the wrong way. When you're older, you'll understand. But I hate you.
Yes.
I really hate you. You make me like you're just this dark cloud hanging over my marriage to your father. Can you change? Can you be a different person?
Mary, you've already ruined one. You've already ruined your parents. No sooner had you been born that you weren't even home from the hospital and you ruined their marriage. Your father deserves a chance at happiness, Mary. Do you know there's men out there who are losing their wives to their own elderly fathers, Mary?
Maybe we could do swaps where you can trade stepkids. Maybe they should, you know how they have like, you know, cap and trade where you can get carbon offsets and trade them on the free market. Maybe you could trade stepkids.
Or like, like that's, or even like, that's like a foreign exchange student type thing. Mm-hmm. Your stepkid into that and be like, bon voyage, Mary, you're off to the Sudan or wherever the fuck, you know,
wherever.
That's an idea too.
I think it makes for a better generation of Z's. Are these the Z's? What are they? What is an A
generation? Gen X, Gen Y, Gen Z, Gen
We have to drill it into their skulls that everybody can be replaced. That's how my kids were raised, and we had a house full of animals. And I used to announce every day, all of you are dispensable.
Absolutely.
I can get another kid. I can get another cat. Shape up. This eight-year-old Mary, she's unpleasant.
Right. And you know what? Take some pointers from the two-and-a-half-year-old. Who seems to have got it all figured out already, Mary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I would do this. I would sit down with her, see if you can change your behavior.
Yeah.
If not, see if your husband would be willing to trade her in for a new one.
Right. And remind your husband, his dad still is out there. So there's competition.
Yes. This next question...
Can I ask you something before we get that? I just had a random thought when we were just trying to figure out what we're up to, Generation Z or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't remember. First of all, I'm like, well, why did we limit ourselves by starting at Generation X? It's so deep in the alphabet.
You're right.
So, but that makes me wonder. Maybe we didn't. Was Generation A, like we're like our founding fathers, were they Gen A? And then like John Adams, whenever he was having problems with John Quincy Adams, he'd be like, ugh, he's so Generation B. did it start then, or did we just pick up three letters before the end of the alphabet?
I don't know. That's a great question.
Because we name hurricanes alphabetically, but it's not like we started the hurricanes with Hurricane Zena.
Yes.
We started at Abigail or whatever.
Right.
So what are we going to do? Is it going to be once Generation Z starts having kids, is a generation?
I don't know.
Do we go into numbers? Do we Z squared?
Well, I think climate catastrophe has solved that.
Going to take care of that. Yeah.
Take that, Greta Thunberg. Is that her name?
I believe you're right. Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
I've only ever read it. I don't know that I've ever heard it pronounced, but Thunberg sounds right.
Uh-huh. Well, that would imply 26 generations between us and George Washington, right? Aren't there 26 letters in the alphabet?
There are. Yeah.
I don't know if... I think it's
240 years, and a generation is every 20. So we're getting...
No.
Or at least 10 generations, probably.
Yeah. I mean, there is actually the grandson of, who was it? William Henry Harrison's or Pierce?
Yeah.
Did you see the grandsons are still alive? Because he was born in 1820.
Yeah, one of those dirty old bastards had a kid at like 80 or something. Uh-huh. And then... Yeah, like that's happened. Like he has a kid at like 80, and then that kid had another son when he was old. So like 150 years have passed, and we're only two generations sometimes.
Yeah. All right. Let's go to our next question.
Okay.
My husband and I were invited to a dinner party at the home of a very high class, prominent society leader who has a reputation for entertaining beautifully. My husband's widowed sister
sounds like someone's going to Mar-a-Lago.
Mm-hmm. My husband's widowed sister came to town unexpectedly, so I telephoned my hostess, and I asked if I could bring our house guest. She asked, is your house guest a male or a female? I said, she's my husband's widowed sister. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't believe what this so-called high-class society lady said to me. She said, and I quote, oh, dear, that's too bad. We already have three extra women. If you could bring a man, I would be delighted. But we don't need any more women. Have you ever heard of anything to top this? Yeah. Bringing your depressed widow to a high-class dinner party. How dare you? These are high society, prominent people who entertain beautifully. Why would they want a beautiful party to be ruined by some moping widow?
Yes, I think you're exactly right. I mean, they're trying to put on a good party for everyone. And, you know, you're now all of a sudden you want to add a dowager to the mix.
When they already have enough women, there's a shortage of men.
Right. Yeah. It's like, oh, wow. What a great party. Hey, who brought Margaret Dumont? You don't need her.
And these are high class, high society people who enjoy beautiful parties. How are you? Oh, wonderful. I bought Apple at $2 and now it's worth $5 million a share. How are you? Oh, our yacht in Corsica needed new paint, but other than that, things are fine. And you, the woman with the bags under her eyes, sniffling.
Dressed all in black.
Wearing all black and not touching her food. What's up with you? My husband was in hospice for 3 weeks. Well, this is a high-class society dinner party with only beautiful people. Please leave.
You know, exactly. Yeah, but if she wants to be petty, right, and it's, you know, somebody's trying to throw the best party, and this person is like, well, we already have too many women, so if you could please just bring a man. If you want to be petty about it, fine. Dig up the husband.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You drag him there.
You wanted the man? Here he is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
There should be an equal number of men and women at a high-class society function.
If they didn't want, look it, if people really wanted depressed old widows at their parties, every Catholic school in the world wouldn't have bingo on a Friday night.
Right. Right.
That's why we have bingo, to send the old depressed widows there while the rest of us.
And if you're in mourning, why are you going to a high class society party where they entertain beautifully? You should be home crying, not having a good time, trying to meet other men. How dare you?
How dare you? How dare you? It's going to be cold very soon. There are mittens that need to be knitted. There.
We're helping people, Kevin.
Yes. And speaking of, you know, you asked me, that's a good question to ask me, because, you know, I'm famous for throwing great parties.
Yes.
And I just want to let you know that I will be throwing this year Thanksgiving dinner. Can we count on the David Feldman to be
in all seriousness? In all seriousness.
In all seriousness.
I may show up. I'm being serious. I know we have a running joke about, you know, but I may show up.
Oh, wow.
Now, do you have, let's see, do you have B-list, C-list? I'm going to assume there are no A-list celebrities because you do my show. So that's all.
I'm asking you, so I started on the D-list. And I'm going to work.
All right. Well, I'm going to be stuck in the city for Thanksgiving.
Oh, yeah? Okay. Yeah. Well, we'll talk about it off the air if you're actually.
I have a history of sometimes doing the most depressing holiday dinners. I've taken my kids to McDonald's for certain holidays just so they'd remember it.
Yeah, I'm down for that.
Okay.
All right.
Dear David, let's keep going because I think we're helping people. You know, you live, you die, and in between, you help people. That's why we were put on this planet. Did you know that, Kevin Bartini?
We are here to serve one another.
We are here to serve. And you're going to serve me at Thanksgiving.
I am.
Yeah. My thighs. Serve my thighs and one breast. I think I'd be delicious.
Mm. I think.
I made somebody nervous. Did that go down the wrong pipe? The wrong hole?
Yeah, I just had one moment where I thought I could be cool and take a quick sip of coffee.
Uh-huh.
And it went directly into my lungs. I'm not sure how that happened, but I was just percolating for a second. Sorry.
By the way, the only complaint I have about your beautiful wife is she doesn't let you clap on the coffee maker in the morning.
No. The clapper didn't work properly. That's the only reason. I got rid of it because it did not work. I still have the coffee maker next to my bed. And not joking about that. Not lying. And other people have followed my example. I have heard from folks on social media who have heard me talk about this on your program and have actually done it.
It's a brilliant
idea. Wonderful idea. It's brilliant. It's the greatest thing in the world.
Well, the only problem is, it's better to have somebody serve you coffee in bed.
Well, that's what we call a life goal, David.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be able to afford that. I mean, listen, it's a personal tragedy that I am 40 years old and still cannot afford to have someone serve me coffee in bed. I'm hoping that changes by the time I'm 50. Hashtag life goals.
Here's a joke that never works.
Okay.
I left my girlfriend breakfast, dinner, and lunch in bed.
Mm-hmm.
I'm incontinent.
Well, what was the old joke? As a doctor said that I'm going to need a blood.
Oh, hang on for 1 second. Now, tell that joke. Okay. One of my sons is the funniest person I've ever met. And, well, that's not fair, but he's incredibly funny. And I've told this joke, his variation on this joke. This will be the fourth time.
It's been told.
But you do the joke. This is what Dom Herrera used to tell.
Yeah.
Tell the joke.
Yeah. It was a doctor said I need a urine sample, a semen sample, a blood sample, and a fecal sample before you leave the office. I said, no problem. And I left in my underwear.
Right. So my son.
Is that a joke, right?
Okay. So my son grew up in comedy clubs and he used to hear that joke all the time.
Right.
Like he was, I'm serious.
Like 8 years old.
Younger. I swear to God. He heard that joke. And so he's visiting me with his girlfriend. And he says to me, you know that joke? I came up with a better version of it. I go, all right, let's hear it. He says, my doctor called. He said, I need a blood sample, a semen sample, and a stool sample. So I sent him a stool sample. I was so proud of him. My listeners have heard. When you're a proud father, you're a proud father. And when he did that, I went, oh, my God, I'm so proud of you, son. Yeah, it's a better joke.
Yes, that is a better joke. That is a great joke.
My doctor. Yeah, I'm really, you know, what's interesting with my kids is I realize that I didn't really raise them so much as just lie to them. All I did was just do jokes and bits. Because I, my ex-wife knew exactly what she was doing. Mm-hmm. I had nothing to do. I really didn't. So I just made jokes.
So she was more the disciplinarian and the get them to soccer practice. And you were.
I just went for the ride. I'm serious. I couldn't be trusted to make any decisions. I knew that from the beginning. So I was like the third kid with authority. Yeah. All right. This next question. Anyway, both my kids are just so effing funny.
Yeah. And I met your daughter. She was wonderful.
She helped you out
5 years ago
at the George Carlin Way. What do you call it? The ceremony?
That was the unveiling 5 years ago last week.
We are talking to the man personally responsible for George Carlin Way in New York City.
That's right.
You were fought every step of the way. The church, the Catholic Church, did not want a George Carlin Way.
It did not. It took 3 years. I got to battle the Catholic Church for 3 years.
Yep.
Yep. And you know what? Honestly, the cool, one of the coolest things was when we were putting together the unveiling ceremony, and Kelly Carlin was, you know, she was inviting her guests and whatnot. And I remember being very excited when she, because you and I did not know each other yet. We had not met. And when she said, oh, and Hannah Feldman is going to be there to volunteer to help us out. She's David Feldman's daughter. And I was like, whoa, what? Really? Yeah. And I was very excited. She, but that you might be there as well. I was such a fan. And I don't know if I ever told you that, but that was very exciting.
That's me. Very sweet of you. And then at Caroline's that night, Gilbert.
Yeah. Gilbert crushed it.
Remember what he did?
Yes, Gilbert did a brilliant. This is one of the great lost gems of sets and comedy. And I say that because someone somewhere, maybe they're listening, was there in the audience and filmed it on their cell phone. They posted this online, but it got taken down at some point. And I'm speaking for Gilbert as well, who has said this. He wishes it would be posted again so he could see it. But what happened was he went about seventh or eighth on the night, and it was a big tribute to George Carlin and
a lot of tears.
Chell and Colin Quinn and Jim Norton and all these, the biggest names in New York.
What a big influence George had on them.
They all were very, very funny, but everybody had a moment where they were earnest talking about what an influence and how great. So by the time Gilbert had gone up, he was about the eighth person, and he opened something just, you know, how much he loved George. And people by that time had gotten over clapping for Joe. They're like, okay, let's just hear the funny. So he didn't get a reaction like everybody else. And so he took in that one moment, brilliant. He just turned it. And he was like, oh, okay, well, fuck George Carlin. And he did probably 10 minutes of just riffing off of fuck George Carlin.
I'm glad he's dead. His daughter was there. His brother was there.
Died.
Yeah.
Sitting on either side of me, his brother and his daughter. I was sitting between the two of them. And although Kelly now says it was brilliant and funny, in the moment, I felt a bit tense.
Oh, really? Because I heard she was laughing hysterically.
She was laughing. Patrick was not. I mean, Gilbert was like, better than the day my children were born was the day I found out George Carlin died. I talked to the doctor, and he told me to my delight that George Carlin suffered. It was 10 brutal, brilliant minutes off the cuff, which was so good. His set was so brilliant that that year, we were named the Time Out New York named that show the number two comedy show of the year on their final, you know, the one that beat us was Tig Notaro did something at one of the Carnegie or somewhere where she took off her shirt to show her mastectomy scars and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, she beat us out, but they specifically pointed out Gilbert's.
It's too bad Gilbert didn't get to follow Tig when she did that.
He's such a genius. He is.
I love him. I do. I love Gilbert.
Yeah. Have you gotten to the point with Gilbert where he acts like he knows your name? Or does he still act like you're an absolute stranger?
I don't know. There's an episode that he did on this podcast. That I got fan mail from Zimbabwe from that.
Yeah.
It's one of the fun. If you go to davidfeldmanshow.com, just there's a search button, search for Gilbert Gottfried and listen. It's an hour, I think, of some of the funniest stuff we've ever done on this show. It really is. Kevin Bartini.
The funny thing about Gilbert is the thing is you have to understand is, of course, Gilbert Gottfried has been famous for 40 years, you know, recognizable, famous, can't walk down the street without somebody recognizing him. And people, of course, because he's a comedy legend, are always coming up to him and blah, blah, blah. And so he always has this way about him that he's not sure if he knows you or what, you know, where you know each other from, because everybody knows Gilbert way better than he knows you.
Right.
So even though, I mean, I've opened for him on the road numerous times. We've been to parties together. He mm-hmm. was at the George Carlin stuff. We've been, you know, I've done his charity show for his kid's school. We've been on celebrity things together. We've met 20 times at least in our lives. Every time I see him, I feel like I'm introducing myself to him in the same way that I would introduce myself to my great grandmother in her final days of dementia.
Right.
Like, hey, you remember me. It's the weirdest thing. But then he always snaps like, oh, yeah, now I remember where you are.
I do that with everybody. I assume.
Do
I assume nobody knows who I am. I assume they, hey, Kevin Bartini, those questions were given to me. They weren't sent to our show. But if you do have questions, if you have personal problems, and if you're listening to this show, you most likely do,
mm-hmm.
go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the mm-hmm. Ask Me Anything button, and Kevin and I will solve your problems. I thought we did a pretty good job answering. I guess these were originally old questions that were sent to some advice columnist from like 30 years ago. It's kind of fun, isn't it?
Huh? Yeah, I wonder how things turned out for the different people. That'd be kind of interesting to do a retrospective on the old Dear Abby and actually find out how her advice worked out.
I think if we ever do this show as a live stream, I would like you and me to just have people call in and you and I solve their problems. I think I'm good at solving people's problems.
Yes. I think we could do that.
You know why? Because I don't care if it's bad advice.
Mm-hmm.
If you're stupid enough to act on anything I told you to do, you deserve what happens to you.
That's on you. I think we could do that.
Here's some advice that is not stupid.
Oh.
Catch a Rising Star, Princeton, November 15th and 16th. They have a headliner who you will effing love. His name is Kevin Bartini. Go see Kevin Bartini, November 15 and 16 at Catch a Rising Star in Princeton. And I understand you are about to go do John Fugelsang's show. He has a new time slot and he's on a new and even better channel over at Sirius XM. I think it's Sirius Progress, correct?
I know it's channel 127. I don't know if they're calling it Progress or Sirius whatever, but channel 127, yes, John's brilliant chat show Tell Me Everything has moved to prime time here in New York City weeknights from 9 p.m. till midnight, and that's drive time out in Los Angeles. And
exciting,
honored to have been invited on the very first show.
That's
and whereas
exciting.
You were invited to be on the very last show of the daytime, as I understand.
I was
right?
on when his last show, yes.
You were on the last one last week, and now I'm kicking it off. So,
wow.
This is going to be great. It's you know, for me, doing a radio show at night as opposed to 3 p.m. means I don't have to set my alarm clock. So that's fun.
And those are the kind of shows I used to listen to as a kid. I never listened to morning radio. I would listen to shows that started, you know, at 9 p.m.
Sure.
They don't really have those kind of shows on AM radio. It's all political now. But there used to be these silly talk shows that went from like 9 to midnight. And the one, because I'm an insomniac, I used to listen to the ones that went from like midnight till 5 in the morning, which were incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's where the freaks come out. This is
like
this show is
Joey Reynolds show. And I remember doing that one once. And there was a bunch of them out in New York City before my time. But it's a totally different thing. Sometimes when you're in a radio studio at like 1 in the morning, it's a different feeling.
Well, that's what I'm trying to capture with this show.
Yeah.
This is for people.
Yeah.
And didn't you experience it?
Experience what?
My show, The Right Way.
What do you mean?
Didn't you before we started, you told me you had something in bed. I was in bed with you.
Oh yeah. You were in bed with me. Yeah, no, I listen to, as I fall asleep every night, I listen to podcasts and, cause I can't shut my mind off.
Uh-huh.
And so I don't know. I was listening to one about like New York City history, the Bowery Boys. It's a great podcast, by the way. And I guess I had dozed off as it ended. and my Spotify then just automatically started playing your podcast because I had been listening to it, I guess, earlier in the day. And so, yeah, weirdly, in some twilight half sleep, I started to hear your voice. And
we have actual audio of Kevin listening to my podcast in bed. Can we play that?
Please do. Yes.
That's Kevin listening to a podcast.
That's Jess right next to me snoring because I don't snore. My wife.
And his dates.
Walmart, after having destroyed American.
Oh. Those are his dates. And then he decides, you know, he's dreaming about having sex with these women, so he unzips his fly, right? And he whips out his Italian sausage. That's Kevin Bartini now, ready for sex. He's whipped out his... That's it. That's Kevin Bartini's Italian sausage.
They don't... David, they don't...
And this
they don't
is,
call me the Italian stallion just because my back is hairy.
And this is the sound of Kevin making love to his dates while listening to my show. Here we go. This is... Catch Rising Star in Princeton, November 15th and 16th. I love you, Kevin. Stay on the line for 1 second.
Okay.